But don't start it until you're ready.
How do you start it?
I think you just did. Go to more.
Yeah, I think you're recording.
All right, I guess we're going to get started here. For those of you that may not know me, I'm Paul Kasson. I'm the operations manager here at the ASRC Whiteface Mountain Field Station. Happy to introduce our speaker for our third lecture in the Falconer series. Phil Snyder is the laboratory manager at the Adirondack Lake Survey Corporation, and his talk is entitled Acid Rain in the Adirondacks, the Progress Toward Recovery.
All right, well, hi everybody. Glad to be here and sharing this all with you guys. This is my first presentation via Zoom, so bear with me here. But like Paul said, I've been with the Adirondack Lake Survey Corporation since 1999. Started as a chemist and then as laboratory manager, and more recently I've been doing a lot of the field work and research as the organization has changed a little bit. So I've gotten to take part in a lot of the different areas of the operation, and I've gotten to see a lot of the way that everything operates and take part in the research. So it's been really good experience. Like Paul said, we're talking about acid rain and the progress towards recovery and a lot of the good work that's happened here throughout the years and more recently. A little bit of background for anybody who's not aware. Acid rain is a combination of sulfur dioxide and nitric oxides reacting in the atmosphere, creating strong mineral acids, which then are deposited on the landscape and our aquatic systems. There are natural sources such as volcanoes and decaying vegetation, but the bulk of this is a result of man-made sources, fossil fuel consumption, especially with coal. Some of the effects, we have leaching of calcium in the soils, nutrient ratios that become out of whack with higher aluminum concentrations. That aluminum then changes to a toxic form as it's leached into our waterways. The leaching of calcium from things like red spruce needles and maple trees, which then make them less resistant to disease and insects. Brief timeline here, just pretty much with the beginning of the Industrial Revolution in the late 1800s, saw a lot of coal being used. Intercontinental Railroad helped spread that across the country, and coal really fueled the Industrial Revolution and helped us along the way, but then of course that has some downsides as well. The use of the coal and the emissions from it really peaked in the 1970s. People became more aware of the fact that the emissions from coal were having harmful effects. In 1973, just after the Clean Air Act amendments passed, the emissions from coal peaked at about 28 million tons. And that was when some of the devastation from these emissions really became clear. During the 1980s, the problem became more well understood, but there was no real monitoring in place to chart the effects that this was having across the landscape. In 1983, the Adirondack Lake Survey Corporation was started. And this was to really develop a comprehensive database of the effects that these emissions were having across the Adirondack landscape. Starting in the early 70s, people had begun noticing that once productive lakes had become either very reduced in the night type and number of fish they had, or completely fishless altogether. So needed to find out what the baseline the baseline effects that this was having, which lakes were being affected, how they were being affected, which still had fish, and how different lake types reacted. So the Adirondack Lake Survey was born out of that in order to really create this comprehensive look at the Adirondack ecosystem. As a result of some of that work, the Clean Air Act amendments of 1990 were signed by George H.W. Bush. And these really built the foundation for the work towards recovery, reducing emissions, creating regulations, and creating a more long-term approach to reducing these and studying the environment. And of course, not to spoil the ending here, but that worked pretty well. It took several decades, but really what we started to see, especially in the last 10 years, is the result of the progress that we've made, the return of fish to certain areas, and healthy brook trout populations returning to their once natural waters. And you might recognize this guy here, but so the trout have really started to come back as a result of the regulations that we've implemented. So back to the origins of the Adirondack Lake Survey Corporation was really the flagship study that came out of this was the 1984 to 1987 Adirondack Lake Survey. This was a very huge undertaking. Nothing like this had really been done before on this scale. Sampled 1,469 waters over 3 years, between half an acre and 700 acres. 352 of those waters were found to have summertime pH values that were below 5. No fish were captured in 346 of those. And of those, it was estimated that over 100 had become fishless as a direct result of acidification. And the majority of the hardest impacted area was in the southwest corner of the Adirondacks, Five Ponds Wilderness Area, the Adirondack Wilderness Area, around Stillwater and Big Moose. These were the first lakes to encounter a lot of the emissions as they moved up from the Midwest. And this area has very thin soils with very low acid neutralizing capacity. So these lakes were directly impacted and impacted quickly. And then as you see, the waters that didn't have fish tended to be smaller, shallower at higher elevations, meaning that they were more susceptible to the emissions and were characterized by their low ANCs and low calcium concentrations and high aluminum values. One of the major outcomes of the 84-87 study was the 1990 interpretive report. Also another major undertaking, this combined scientists from across the US and major universities, even international work, to really take a look at this giant database that had been created and to try and make something of it and to come up with some conclusions going forward. One of the things that helped actually steer the 1990 Clean Air Act amendments and determined that sulfate was the major source of acidity in Adirondack waters, originating largely from acid deposition. Find the role of DOC, which contributes to the natural acidity, but then also has interactions with the anthropogenic acidity in defining how these waters reacted. And one of the other major things is the lake classification system. Defining out these lakes by type really helped to focus on the ones that were the most susceptible to acidification. Thin till drainage waters, which are those which have very thin soils. They typically have inlets and outlets so that water turns over fairly quickly and have very low acid neutralizing capacity. So that anything that falls quickly moves into the water. Also, lakes like mounded seepage, which have no inlets or outlets and receive all of their inputs directly from precipitation. So as a result of that 90 interpretive report, needed to figure out a way to go forward with the monitoring to really gauge how the Clean Air Act amendment was going to work, how much time it was going to take for some of these lakes to start to turn around, and to really just keep a long-term monitoring approach onto how these waters were reacting. So the ALTM was born in 1992. This actually incorporated 17 waters that had been studied by Charlie Driscoll at Syracuse University going back as far as 1982. And it had a cross-section of the lakes that had been taken from the original survey based across all lake classification types. And you know, it included lakes that were fishless, lakes that had fairly healthy fish populations, and was across a fairly wide geographic range across the Adirondacks. Another project that was going on concurrently was sponsored by the EPA. The ALTM was actually a partnership with ECIRCLA, now it's NYSERDA. The EPA started this other concurrent program, whereas the ALTM was 52 lakes sampled on a monthly basis year round. The EMAP waters were just a summertime sampling, and there was some crossover between the two. So both of those studies complemented each other and really made up the core of what would become the long-term monitoring database. As we moved on from the ALTM and really started to build up a pretty good database, we sought to complement that further with some additional types of monitoring. In 2001, the ALSC took over the Whiteface Mountain Cloud Project from ASRC, who had started it back in the early 90s. We were able to sort of revive that project, get it going on a yearly basis, starting in June and going right through to the end of September. Required some new method development and really getting the instrumentation and the data logging going. And started out in 2001, sampling on an hourly basis. We kept that up for 5 years. As we looked at the data, as well as the amount of work on the lab, the hourly sampling, we were able to go back to a 3-hour bulk sample and then to a 12-hour bulk sample as we did some statistical analysis on that to find that these were also representative of what we were seeing, along with the meteorological data that we were collecting with that. And so that really complemented the ALTM program by providing a more immediate snapshot of what was coming into the Adirondacks in terms of acidification. Another major project that also complemented this was our Eastern and Western Adirondack stream surveys. Very well coordinated effort between USGS, ALSC, and the DEC. Also a pretty major undertaking. The Western Adirondack stream survey started in 2003, and that encompassed a 1 million acre study area, 200 first order streams, and three samplings a year, which were coordinated to coincide with specific seasonal patterns. One of the ones that was always challenging was trying to hit the high water flow during spring snowmelt. After years of doing that, I can tell you it almost always falls around the third week of April. But getting out in that window, we tried to collect the samples over a very tight window, usually between 2 to 3 days. And so that required a lot of coordination of people going out in the field to all of these sites, returning the samples to the lab, and then getting those turned around and analyzed. We also did that during the late summer during base flow, and then again in the fall for leaf off. So all three of these projects over the course of over the course of 30 years, but really, you know, longer than that in some cases, led up to some major achievements in how we handled the data, how we handled the collection, and were able to string together a long-term database that was fairly seamless from one time to another. As technology changed, as instrumentation and methods changed, had to be very mindful of how these changes would affect the data set and try and handle things in a way that wouldn't cause any sort of jumps in the data as a result of anything that we were doing. So a rigorous quality control system to ensure that data over a long period of time, over 40,000 samples collected, 500,000 data points, all managed by the very good staff that we had, our IT department in creating and managing that, getting that data out to the public on our website, delivering it to researchers, policymakers, who were then able to use that and turn it around into publications, legislation, and then work that we did in-house on some publications of our own, which would then help steer the research that we were doing. One of the milestones that we really considered pretty important to the work that we did, done in very much in coordination with Dr. Greg Lawrence at USGS and our program manager, James Duquette, was our publication in 2013 in Environmental Science and Technology. As we started to see lakes recovering from acidity, there were some interesting things going on in terms of how they were reacting, in some cases recovering more quickly than we had anticipated and in different ways. And based on work that Dr. Lawrence had done looking at the streams from the Western Adirondack stream survey and the interactions with DOC and toxic aluminum, we used that to then examine what was going on in our lakes. So one thing that we found is that DOC is increasing. As you can see here, the data points here each represent 47 lakes, averaged mean concentration for DOC for each year. With the exception of the 7 lakes, 40 of them showed a significant increasing trend in dissolved organic carbon. This is explained by the fact that as acidification decreased, we would see increasing decomposition of the forest floor. That DOC would then make its way into our waters. This is often referred to as the browning of Adirondack lakes. As acidification decreased, you know, that beautiful clear blue color of these highly acidified lakes started to change. In this case, it happened to be changing for the better. So as the DOC entered the lakes, acidification decreased, we started to see how this was interacting with some of our other chemical parameters. Again, as we explored this and how we could use this to examine other key ecosystem parameters like ANC, base cation surplus, and toxic inorganic aluminum, we looked to Dr. Lawrence again, who said that the base cation surplus might be a more effective way of examining this. And then Waller suggested that DOC had a larger effect on ANC and was critical in developing targets. So stemming from that, we started to look at DOC and base cation surplus as these lakes began to show recovery, in trying to potentially identify a metric that would help us examine which lakes were closer to that point than others. The other thing that we were seeing in relation to this is when we would examine our data set, we would always use charge balance as an indicator of complete analysis. And what we were starting to see was anion deficits were increasing as DOC increased. And that was explained largely because the strong acid anion from DOC was making up the bulk of that. So when we looked at anion deficiency versus dissolved organic carbon, we saw it was a very linear relationship. And from this relationship, because DOC is a conglomerate of different organic acids, it was hard to quantify. So what this relationship did was it allow us to assign a value, an average value to the DOC across Adirondack waters that we could then use to calculate DOC for each of our lakes. So we were able to calculate the strong organic ion from that relationship. The 0.60 was represented by the slope. And so for every micromole of DOC, we were able to determine that it was contributing 1.8 microequivalents per liter of charge. We were then able to use that DOC to calculate a base cation surplus. And by taking that DOC into account in the base cation surplus, it represented more of a robust way of looking at the recovery of these lakes than just A and C alone. So looking at the base cation surplus, then we could equate that back to how we were seeing losses in inorganic monomeric aluminum as well. As you see at the top represents data from 1994. We see that base cation surplus was less in 1994, and the slope of the line for the inorganic monomeric aluminum was greater, meaning that the lower the BCS value, the higher the inorganic monomeric aluminum value that we would find in the water. By 2011, the slope of that line had changed drastically as a result of increasing DOC inputs. So this BCS value could then be used as a key ecosystem indicator for acid base and provide guidance for our lake and streams as far as neutralizing. It also created a very bright line that allowed us to say that at a BCS value of 0, we would expect to see toxic inorganic monomeric aluminum, the effects of that start to decrease. And this graph right here is taken from the manuscript, our 2013 publication. And this is pretty much the crux of what we were looking at in terms of a tipping point towards recovery. You can see it at the bottom here. In about 2007, there was a major split in the speciation of aluminum as the DOC had increased. So that major split came, we see this across our database. Each one of these points in this graph represents 500 waters. So this is a pretty widespread phenomenon that as recovery progressed, we kind of hit this point where emissions had dropped, increasing DOC had started removing inorganic monomeric aluminum and converting it to organic. And recovery really sort of kicked off right around 2007. Excuse me a second. I have to put my circles on. So result of this work ongoing, using the BCS values and the strong organic ion ratio, sometimes lovingly referred to as the buckaroos, that ratio provided a way to normalize the DOC values that can be applied across waters and gives a nice value that we can look at in terms of whether or not the certain water might support fish. So we took that, we went back and looked at the original waters that we had from 1984, calculated the base cation ratios for each of those, and then we looked at which waters might have recovered to a certain point since then that we could potentially look at the possibility of those waters now sustaining fish populations. We had to remove certain classifications of waters, mainly carbonate impacted and some thick till seepage waters. But for the most part, this ratio really held pretty well for a lot of the waters that we have. And a ratio of 2.5 was the cutoff. Below that ratio, we found that based on the fish surveys from back in 1984, that those waters were likely to unable to support fish. In 2015, we started working with DEC Fisheries on this, asking them about the possibility of using this as a management tool. We started going and collecting some of these marginal waters, looked at their stocking records and their survey models, or their survey records, and trying to build a more real-world model of where the cutoff for this ratio might be. And one of the waters that we began looking at was Lake Colden. Obviously, Lake Colden's a pretty high-profile water. It did have a historic population of brook trout that had become fishless as a result of acid rain. And the chemistry that we had for Lake Colden showed that it was approaching this cutoff of 2.5, the ratio, that would potentially allow it to support fish again. So this is data going up to 2011. And again, around 2007, 2008 really seems to be the time. There's some certain regulations in New York State about New York State power plants really needed to cut down on their emissions, but things really just changed in that window there. We see that Lake Colden, the DOC, had been increasing by about 5 micromoles per year. The red, toxic inorganic aluminum had been decreasing, and the organic aluminum had taken over the dominant form. You see some values there. One of the other cutoffs that we use for fish survival is an inorganic value of about 2 micromoles. So we see that in 2011, it had just reached that 2 micromole cutoff for the inorganic aluminum. And then when we put in our BCS value there in the dashed line, you can see that the BCS value had just begun to approach zero as well. So this made Lake Colden a pretty good candidate for some further investigation. So we began looking at that as potential for a more intensive research project. Here's some additional chemistry from Lake Colden time series. Again, as we calculated the BCS values, you could see that back in 94, Colden had a BCS value way down of about negative 40. And by 2017 had actually made it above zero into the low 20s at certain points. And at the bottom panel, you can see where that bright red line represents the cutoff of the inorganic, and it had started falling below that as well. So in 2018, we were fortunate to receive a grant through Senator Betty Little's office to sustain some of our fisheries work. And in 2019, we began looking more closely at Lake Colden and some of its tributaries as a way of collecting data that we could then provide to fisheries to possibly, you know, guide some of their stocking if they were going to think about potentially putting fish back into Lake Colden for the first time in over over 30 years. So there's a bathymetric map of Lake Colden. You can see that there's four major inlets running in. The one at the east end runs in from Avalanche Lake. Two on the north side run in from, one's from Caribou Pass, the other is from Algonquin. The one from Algonquin being Cold Brook, which runs, if you're familiar with Lake Colden, runs right past the interior outpost. And then one running off of Mount Colden itself on the south shore. You also see that Lake Colden is a fairly shallow lake. It has a couple of deep water basins, but it's largely under 10 feet and largely about 5 feet. And much of that is supported by the dam on the west side. So as we started investigating, we had actually received a tip from, this is about after about 8 months of sampling, we had gone up to Lake Colden over 10 times doing sampling of the tributaries of the Epi and the Hypolimnion. We had received a report that someone had actually started catching fish there. So we decided to investigate a little bit further. And in almost a year ago today, in the Cold Brook Inlet, we located what we believe to be the first documented fish that was found in one of the Lake Colden tributaries in quite some time. As we were taking a sample, it just happened to be there, and we were pretty excited by that. So we reported that information back to DEC, and so they followed up and decided, you know, they were thinking about stocking it based on some of the chemistry we had given them. And so they decided to perform a survey of the lake. So a month later, after we had seen this fish, we accompanied DEC back up to Lake Colden, where they set nets, and we found fish in the lake. And so that was extremely exciting. That meant that the fish had somehow returned to the lake, exciting for a number of reasons. You know, it also really helped shore up the model that we had been looking at in terms of when fish might possibly be able to survive in a lake based on the chemistry. And just the fact that the chemistry had improved that enough that fish had been able to repopulate the lake and grow and succeed there. They actually found at least 3 year classes of fish, probably up to 3 or 4 years old, various age classes. And so it meant that not only were they in there and they were spawning and they were growing and there was multiple generations. So that was great. You know, that's obviously the success story after a long 30 plus years of studying acid rain, of determining causes, of coming up with solutions, and it really brought everything full circle. But then we had remaining questions. Where did these fish come from? I skipped a little ahead, but the other thing I wanted to say is this was obviously a big deal. This was picked up nationally, the fact that these fish had returned, and this became, you know, a lot of interest was put into this. But So where did the fish come from? Well, a couple of things. Lake Holden was stocked going back to 1941. It was discontinued in 1972 because the fish was just simply not making it. Avalanche Lake was similar. They tried liming it in the 80s, but basically after every stocking, the fish either died off or were just gone very quickly afterwards. The water was simply too acidic. And then the ALSC netted both of those waters in 1987, 2004, and 2011. So we were fairly certain that while that's not 100% confirmation that there was no fish in the lake, you know, they can always miss the nets. It was pretty good confirmation that fish were just not there up until at least 2011. So one of the studies we looked at in thinking about this was Dan Josephson and Cliff Kraft out of Cornell had done a lot of work on Hanadaga, which was a similar situation in that it essentially became fishless in 1980. As water quality improved, small populations of fish that had taken refuge in the tributaries began working their way back into the lake and had started repopulating the lake, and again became were able to spawn and produce multiple generations and multiple year classes. So given the fact that we had seen the fish in the tributaries, you know, that was one of the things we looked at. So we took some of the fish from the netting and the electroshocking that the DEC had done in the tributaries, and we had genetic analysis of those fish done. I'm not going to pretend to be a geneticist. This is a very nice, colorful graph here. Essentially, what it says is this was done by this was done by the University of Albany. Name of the doctor. He looked at several different varieties of trout that he had studied and done genetic workups on, and was basically concluded that the fish in Lake Holden had descended from Temiskaming hybrid strains, which originate from stocked fish. So basically this was not a self-sustaining heritage population. These were descendants of stock fish that had either made their way down into Colden, possibly from the late stockings and avalanche, had either been remnants of the original of the stockings from Lake Colden, or had possibly somehow migrated from other stocked waters in the area. What we did find was that the fish that we had captured were at least several generations removed from a typical hatchery fish, meaning that the fish in the lake had been self-sustaining there for several years. So it was pretty interesting. I mean, that these fish could have potentially found refuge. There's always the possibility that they had a hand getting there as well. Someone could have potentially put the fish in there, and we, you know, from Livingston Pond, which is a little bit further down, but you know, there's many possibilities, and we'll never really know the answer to that, but we have at least some direction to look at in how these fish were able to be in there and reproduce. So a few conclusions from that work. The BCS ratio model did prove to be a useful predictor in determining sustainability of fish. We are collecting further data from quite a few other waters to try and refine this model. Waters where we know there's fish, waters where there's still fish haven't returned. And obviously this, you know, regardless of where the fish originated from, the fact that these were self-sustaining fish in a lake that had been fishless for decades really helps give hope for the future that as waters recover, that these fish can once again return to some of their native habitat, provided that the trends in emissions and deposition don't change. Looking back at some of the long-term time series plots of the chemistry, we can see that Lake Colden had just reached a point where it could sustain these fish. Any changes in deposition and acidity back in the other direction could easily push these lakes back to becoming too acidic to sustain fish again, especially at the point now where any buffering capacity that these lakes and the surrounding watersheds had has been depleted by decades of acid rain. So making sure that emissions don't return and is very critical to maintaining the direction, the positive direction that some of these lakes are going in. So therefore the fight is not over yet. Which leads to the last thing I'd like to talk about here is returning to a larger scale monitoring. As we've approached this recovery point and these lakes are now becoming self-sustaining again, it's important to look at where we are across the larger scale so that we can use that information to guide policies going forward for the next several decades. So one of the things that the ALSC in combination with a number of other research institutions have proposed is the 21st Century Adirondack Lake Survey, which would be similar to what was done in 1984, perhaps not as widespread or as intensive, but as representative as that study was. So performing monitoring of a large number of lakes to really see where some of these waters that maybe haven't been looked at in 20 or 30 years, how they're recovering, how some of these small shallow lakes that were vulnerable to acidity may be just as vulnerable to warming temperatures and climate change. As I said, Lake Colden, for example, is a fairly shallow lake. Those are the type of waters that really could be vulnerable to changing climate, warming surface waters, which is another stressor for brook trout as well. We also have a large number of research organizations who have done work throughout the Adirondacks and have created a patchwork of data, but a collaboration between research groups would really give a more complete picture of where we are now as we go forward. We have new technology, we have new management tools, and this collaboration would really give us a good baseline for how we can proceed in the next the next 50 years. So that's pretty much it. I'd like to thank the sponsors, NYSERDA, DC, EPA, who have been with us for 30 years, as well as Senator Betty Little for providing us funds for our more recent work that we were able to accomplish. And thanks. I'll take any questions now.
I have a question on the dissolved organics. I know in our area here, we've seen a lot of reforestation going on. More. It seems like there's just more trees out there. Now, is that playing a role in the Adirondacks, the increasing forest? know, the recovery of from logging from 100 years ago?
I'm not exactly sure. Again, you know, forests aren't really, there's definitely reforestation in a lot of these areas. You know, some of these watersheds were heavily logged, you know, as recently as the 50s. So I'd have to imagine that as these forests grow up and there's more decomposition, you know, there is more organic matter out there. And, you know, perhaps it's not running off as quickly as it used to as we see more forest also. So, it could play a part.
Okay, thanks.
Jim and Janie.
Hey, Phil. Nice talk. Thank you. So
thank you.
I missed a little bit. So you talked a lot about the base cation surplus to, it was organic acid ratio, right? How do you get values for organic acids? It's not something you measure routinely, right? So is it somehow maybe just pass it over quickly and I missed it.
Sure. No, so what we do is we analyze our samples for total dissolved organic carbon.
Right.
So with that DOC value, because DOC is not one compound, it can be a number of different things. So this graph right here, because DOC is a number of different things, basically we looked at DOC values across our waters. And when we calculate a charge balance for those waters, we find an anion deficiency if we don't include any DOC in it.
Yep.
So basically we're sort of finding it by subtraction.
Yep.
We use the relationship between the deficiency to calculate what's basically an average value. And then by finding that amount of charge, that average amount of charge per DOC, and multiplying it by our measured DOC, we come up with basically an equivalency for that acid anion. In order to do that for the entire Adirondacks, it did require this large data set. Because DOC can vary from one lake to another, using this whole data set in order to calculate an average value was necessary.
So with this relationship is for pretty acidic lakes.
It is for pretty acidic lakes. We used waters in that pH value because the DOC anion would be completely disassociated. You would probably need to create a different model for a different, this is fairly unique to Adirondack waters.
Sure.
You would need to create a different model depending on the area you're in for the types of DOC you were dealing with. But yes, by using that low pH, this can be applied across the Adirondacks, but we needed the low pH range for the completely disassociated
anion. Right. Okay, great, thanks. So I did have one more question if no one else is going to jump in.
Sure.
So you based a lot of your talk about recovery on the inorganic monomeric aluminum versus the organic monomeric aluminum, right?
Correct.
And could you just for background, for those of us that are less familiar with this, talk about how, I mean, it sounds like the inorganic version is the toxic time, but when it's tied up in organics, it's not? Or could you just talk about what aluminum does to fish? Sure. And other life?
Yeah, so aluminum is toxic in its inorganic form. Aluminum is multivalent, so it changes its associated hydroxide based on pH. When you have low pH waters, you have this Al plus 3 that tends to associate with inorganics, or like AlOH. Where this becomes harmful to trout is a trout's gills are fairly neutral pH. So when a trout is in acidic water and this which has caused the aluminum to be in its inorganic form, passes across a trout's gills, the pH difference actually causes the aluminum to precipitate on the trout's gills. At a higher pH, when the aluminum is in its organic form, that reaction doesn't happen. So it no longer is toxic to the fish. So it's really the pH difference and the aluminum precipitating and changing forms as it passes through a fish's gills that causes the toxicity.
Okay. Very helpful. Thank you.
Yeah.
There's a question on the chat from Larry Masters. Did some of the trout evolve so as to be more tolerant to levels of acidity that would have been lethal to their forebears?
I would say brook trout are actually fairly acid tolerant. I'm not sure they could evolve to be less tolerant of aluminum. If it's really, it's the strong mineral acids that result from acid deposition that allow the aluminum to be in that form. Even the very acidic DOC doesn't have a pH low enough to cause the aluminum to be in that form. So, I mean, trout have actually evolved to be fairly acid tolerant, but I don't know that they would ever be able to tolerate that. Mark?
I have a question, yes. Phil, great talk, thank you.
Thank you.
Encouraging, certainly, from my perspective, being an angler. I have a question about the fish that you caught by netting in Colden.
Yeah.
Was there any study done? I mean, obviously they're spawning. They came from somewhere. But the thing that interests me is that they're actually growing and the population is growing. And so there's other factors there that I'm interested in terms of the aquatic insect population. Is that recovering? Do you know anything about that? Were there other fish species caught besides brook trout? And so are they feeding on minnows? I guess those are my questions.
I don't really know anything about the aquatic insects. That, again, as I was talking about the resurvey, that is something that, you know, hopefully we could look at in some of these waters. And then we did not catch any other fish species. There are crayfish in Lake Colden. There's newts, salamanders as well. So there is a forage base in there. Brook trout actually tend to do really well as a monoculture. They often don't like having other fish species sharing the water with them.
Yeah, I would guess that there's a certain midge population as well. It'd be interesting to have a stomach pump on one of the caught trout to see, but I would be willing to guess that the midge population is probably a big part of their diet, which is also an encouraging sign that the sediment in the lake as well is recovering and improving.
Yeah, definitely. I don't know as much about that area. I know there's people who have definitely looked at the differences between the biota that make up fishless lakes versus lakes with fish. And I know that can change when you introduce or the fish introduce themselves into that system. And as the acidity changes, as the pH rises, you might have different varieties of those things occupying that space.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question. Does the is the DEC in any level of conversation or actual planning to start to stock fish in some of these lakes, or is it a little early for that?
No, that was actually part of what we were discussing with them as we were looking at Lake Colden. As we saw that this, as this water chemistry was improving to that point, was the possibility of adding stocking to Lake Colden. And because there is a self-sustaining population of fish in there now, not only is that not necessary, that's not something that they would want to do. There's been a push at the DEC over the last several years not to introduce hatchery fish into natural populations. And there was actually a something I didn't touch on at all in this, but we worked with them on. There was a press release from the DEC not too long ago about how that they were going to stop stocking 13 waters based on the fact that those fish were naturally reproducing. And so rather than adding these additional fish in every year and possibly outcompeting the ones that were naturally reproducing, they were going to let them kind of run the natural course. So that's kind of the way they've been moving over the last several years.
I have one more question.
Sure.
Phil, do you know how, you said there in Colden, there were some, so obviously it's deep enough for the fish to hold over in the wintertime. Were those trout caught in the deep section or in the shallows?
It was netted in late September, and we found that the lake was completely thermally mixed. It was actually 55 degrees from top to bottom, even in the deep water. So those fish were actually caught in all different locations.
Hmm.
It was actually just up at Lake Colden last week, and we found that the water was stratified over the deep hole. So I imagine if you were to do that now, you might find those fish deeper. But at that point when we did that, the whole lake was one temperature. So they were caught all over the place.
So that was just before the spawning period, right? I think spawning is October.
Yeah, correct.
Great.
Anybody else? All right. Well, I very much appreciate everybody's attendance, and it was fun. And
power didn't even go out.
The power didn't go out.
They're flickering.
Yeah, the roof didn't leak. So,
thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Phil.
Yeah. Hey, thanks, everybody. It was a great talk. And, yeah, thanks for coming, and we'll do it again soon. Have a good evening.
Thanks,
where do I leave?
Take care, everybody.
Ciao.
Bye, Mark.
Bye-bye.
Say close for everyone or something.
Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Phil.
Hey, Sue.
Oh, thank it's you. Sue. Hey, Sue.